We're rolling.
Well, all right, good morning, everyone.
Good
seeing you all. I'm gonna kindly ask you all to stop talking about pickling turkey gizzards so that we can begin a service. It is not our subject for today, Patty. Trust me, I will never have a service. Put this on film, I will never have a service where the topic is how to properly pickle turkey gizzards. I promise you that.
Not in the Bible, huh?
Well, I think there's a place in there.
I think we'll find it somewhere.
I'll have to find it.
And Elijah just held aloft the turkey gizzards and said, "This is how one doth child be clothed correctly."
They pickle all the dogs.
That's what they use for communion vessels.
All right, good to see you all. Today we're talking about what makes something valuable. And I'd like to, Jesus has something very interesting to say about a woman who gives a very little amount of money in the collection, so to speak, at the synagogue. But he talks about how valuable that is. And I'd like to play with that. How do we know something is valuable? How do we say something is valuable or not valuable? And what does that mean? Of course, in light of Jesus' words and our own spiritual life and how we deal with money and all that good stuff. So, good seeing you all this morning. Good chatting with you. Our first song. He's got the whole world in his hands. You know this one well. Sing it with me, kids. Oopsie. Grab this one right. And here we go. He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. Deal with the rest of the family as best as possible. So Just keep her in prayers, there's a lot going on with that, and,
Now, you know, when they cremate people and that stuff, they're planting a tree. They're not putting them in the cemetery. They plant a tree for them, like we did for Tracy. So that's...
Not my, not my
fault. We got land to put a tree.
You got land to put a tree on.
There you go. Let's see, some other, prayers. We've been keeping Patty in our prayers with a number of, Patty has changed her doctoring situation, which seems to be working out pretty well. How are the other health things going with that? From what you told me, and correct me if I'm wrong, they are delaying a knee replacement for some therapy things that might help. Yours is moving around pretty well, so.
And I felt really bad for her, so I decided to blow my knee off.
That one step at a time here with a...
We're meeting a group rate.
Yeah. Two surgeries, 2 days, one room. We're done.
On that note, Jane, yes, Jane's body turned left and the knee turned right, and it didn't end well. So we are keeping Jane.
I took one for the team.
There you go.
Football injury.
I thought of it, just looked at your warranty and realized it ran out. It was his birthday, so yeah.
Yeah.
But
I ran out 5 years for
football. You have
to read
all of them. Other prayers we'd like in our group. We love. Jen, it's great to see you here. Great to have you here. Jen has been all over the place. It's actually been really neat. Not to tell too much out of school, but one neat thing about, well, since the divorce in many ways, you've connected a lot with your family, and I think that's wonderful. And so, anyway, so many weekends, instead of coming to church, she's off gallivanting with her sisters, which I think is a fair thing to do. So last weekend, she was off at dinner theater watching The Music Man. So.
Was that
a chain? Yes. So, but we're glad you can be with us, and and honestly though, I think it's I haven't talked about it much, but I think you reconnecting with your sisters and all that is awesome, and a lot of fun, even if it means missing you at church once in a while. other prayers we'd like to lift up as a family together. Things going on in our world. Yeah.
I keep my uncle Jim in our prayers. He's been diagnosed with COVID. He's had a triple bypass, so he may be hospitalized with it. Just keep him in your prayers.
Thank you, ma'am. So Jim, you said?
Jim.
We got to keep Beth's mother in her prayers. She had a heart surgery. So she's doing good. She had the same surgery I did that we already felt.
Yeah.
Basement.
Okay.
They had to open up her chest and everything.
Yours was laparoscopically, wasn't it? Okay, yeah. So it's a little more recovery time, but still the surgery went well?
Yep.
Excellent.
She's doing good. She's awesome. At the Marshfield, or she's still in ICU at Marshfield. Yeah. But she's doing good. And Jane's got a job at the... Beth's got a job at the golf course up there in Arcadia.
Nice.
Cool. Country Club and that, so.
Awesome.
She's no longer working at Larry's. She's up there. Anyways, keep her family in our prayers.
And I do have one person too. Friend Gloria, who used to live in the building with me. In 18 months, she's lost her daughter. She had a stroke. She's lost her granddaughter. She's lost her niece. She's lost her older brother, which only left 2 out of 9 kids left. And the younger brother just called her and said he's got stage 4 cancer and he will make it a little bit longer. So she's lost just way too much in that period of time.
This week, it actually turned out pretty good, but the day after Cassie's dad passed away, I got a phone call from Cassie that some tests came out a little weak for bad for mom, so they brought her to the hospital. So, of course, in my own tactical diplomacy, I walk into the ER, and I'm like, what is this, the week for parents dying? And she looks at me like, you know, and I said, what, mommy, you got 1 foot in the grave and 1 foot on a banana peel, which is my grandmother's expression. One foot in the grave and 1 foot on a banana peel.
Okay.
And my grandmother used to love that expression, and so I broke the ice with her. But it turns out the test was it's one of those tests that say something bad could happen. This enzyme kind of creeps up when a heart attack may happen. Turns out there was another reason for it being there, an infection in the lung, a real small one. She barely knew about it. So she got antibiotics and they sent her home that day. So
good. That's good.
Yeah, no, more just scary. More they bring her down there. Oh, this may happen. This is because of these tests. Turns out false alarm. So.
Well, and after my spell, I had a dialysis a week ago Friday. They cut my blood pressure medicines and all that stuff.
Good.
You were talking about that. All right, and how do you feel since then? I know it's very quick soon, but...
I feel fine.
Good deal. You look great. So, hey, all right.
Oh. I was just kind of telling you that. Rusty has to work by himself for a weekend. You have to rest.
Rusty will survive a little rest too, but he may mentally go crazy. But
oh, he had some rest the other day.
What's that? You don't have time for that sort of thing.
Had to get the duct tape off. Take them anywhere you want. You won't feel
the move. Oh, I should. This is technically illegal.
I never get up to 4 or 2:30 in the morning.
Oh, what a sleeping in again, I'll tell you.
Oh, he slept in the other morning till 9 o'clock.
Oh, my goodness.
That was the day after that, yeah. He got up at 2:30 that one morning and worked till, what, 10 that night or 11?
Nope.
Must be a lot of coin difference there in the morning, isn't it?
Why are you giving him ideas, Dave?
That's what I'm trying to get.
I haven't tried anything lately. Don't give him any ideas. We're getting the window replaced Saturday.
Rusty,
Friday, we're
getting
the window
replaced.
Are we
getting to open it up or what?
Yeah. You didn't hear about that?
No.
No, yeah, he did that.
I think of Rusty every time I look out my window now and I see deer in the backyard. And then my first thought is, oh, how beautiful the deer are. The second thought is, if Rusty lived here, he'd
break through the
light comes on?
Boom.
No, it
beeps.
Beeps. The
signal is about what makes something valuable. In today's story from the Bible, Jesus specifically talks about a widow who gives two small coins into the collection at the main temple. And he talks about how valuable that is. And we want to talk today about what makes things valuable and what makes things not so valuable. This clip that I'm going to show you is from a favorite cartoon show of mine. But it's basically a conversation between two characters who have found an ironic love for each other, not a sort of affection between friends. But he starts talking about something he really cares about, that people have made fun of him throughout the show. And he finally shows some care by giving it value as well. Hit it.
Hey, come here. I want to show you something. Okay, look, everybody makes fun of me for getting these, but you're a genius scientist. What do you think? There's little R2-D2s where the George Washington should be.
You know, Jerry, I'm not going to tell you that these will increase in value or even hold their current value. The truth is, you bought them because you like them. They have value to you. That's what matters.
How long are you staying?
Until we find your Rick. I found mine.
I found mine.
Help! There is no escape, my son!
All right. Excellent. Thank you. And so today we'll be talking about value, what makes something value, and ultimately, why is Jesus valuing this gift that this human made that others would not value so much? So, all right. Moving on here. Obviously I'd like to include a newer song and an older song in our services. An old hymn, a song Count Your Blessings, many of you know well. I'll ask you to sing it with me.
Sacrifices. We have been given new lives, new starts, and encouraged. courage to offer that love to others as well. I think I can make it now. The pain is gone. All of those bad feelings have disappeared. This is the rainbow I've been praying for. It's gonna be a bright, bright, sunshiny day. It's gonna be a bright, bright, sunshiny day.
As we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
All right, it's been a couple of years since I sang this song, but I remember singing this with Patty at one point. And so I'm going to ask her to come on up here, join me. A song done by multiple artists. Rusty, name a few who have done this song. A song called My Elusive Dreams.
Oh, Tammy Wyatt and David Houston, I think, probably made it biggest. Yeah, but Tammy Wyatt, George Jones, Tom Jones, Glenn Campbell, the list just goes on and on and on.
Now, Cassie picked the service, picked the song very specifically for this service, so. Of all the songs in the world, Cassie, why this one?
Because they kept chasing something that wasn't valuable and lost what really was.
I follow you.
This story that I'm going to share with you, it's a very short story. It's included in the Gospels of Mark and Luke, but I decided to share with you the one from the Gospel of Luke. By and large, I find Luke is actually of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Luke, I think, is my favorite writer for a number of reasons. So, Luke 21:1-4. Jesus looked and saw some rich people tossing in their gifts to the offering box. He also saw a poor widow putting in 2 pennies. And he said to them, "I tell you, this poor woman has put in more than all the others. Everyone else gave what they didn't need, but she is very poor and gave everything she had." So today I want to talk to you a little bit about value. What makes something valuable, what makes something not so valuable. Jesus looks very specifically at something others would have found not valuable and talks about how valuable it is. Jesus' words are, well, both clear and mysterious at the same time. He says, look at this woman. She has given more than everybody else. Now, obviously, that's a metaphor. It's not literally true because others have given much more money. But he comments that what she gave is more valuable than what rich people gave. And I'd like to talk to you today about what do we mean when we say something is valuable? What do we mean when we say something is precious? What do we mean when we say I must have that, or that is really something important to me? And so, to begin the conversation, sometimes I like to dig into, to dip my toe in the waters of such deep and heavy topics. So, I'm going to start by talking about antiques. The big question to begin will be, what's the difference between a piece of junk and an antique? But before I go there, that's on the agenda. Before I go there, I want to take a moment. I want you to think about one of the most valuable things you have in this world. Just sort of think in your mind. What is one of the most valuable things for you in this world? Just, let's not go completely cliche. Oh, the love of my wife. It's a physical object that you have somewhere in your home, something like that, that is the most valuable to you. Anyone want to share what that might be?
My bathtub.
Your bathtub. Very good. Why is the bathtub the most valuable thing you own, Betty?
Because that's my getaway.
Okay. So that is where you get away from the hustle and bustle of everything else. Excellent. What are the most valuable things you have in your home?
I think I have several.
Pick one at random and tell me why.
Well, things that have been given to me, like my birthday gift and things like that, are valuable to me. People have, personally
thought about me and given it to me with love.
Mm-hmm. And those are the most important things in my life. Fair enough. It's not money or
jewels or,
you
know, any of those kinds of things. It's the things that people do out of love.
What are your thoughts?
Money is valuable to me because I need it.
Bring it out there. What's that song, you know, your love gives me the thrills, but your love don't pay my bills, give me the money. All right, fair enough. Now that song's in my head. Maybe I should have played that for sure. All right. I've called in a resident expert on the difference between junk and antiques. Rusty has worked a lot, actually, with Elmer when he was alive and still works at Elmer's museum. And I've actually had the joy in my time of having a couple of neat conversations with Elmer about the difference between junk and antiques. In other words, why do some things end up in Elmer's museum as treasured items and others get thrown in the junk heap? And we've had some neat conversations about that. But to start, I'm going to ask resident expert Rusty Arm, who has worked there with Elmer for years and now works there with his family. And we can talk about this in general, but Rusty, I'm going to have you start this conversation off. What is the difference between a precious, beloved antique and a piece of junk?
Well, something, of course, are worth more to one person than they are to another. Because, as Jane mentioned, it was probably given to you with a lot of thought, other things that make something more worth more than others is the rarity of something. If there's a lot of a certain item, it's not as valuable, of course, as if there's only one of a kind. Just because something is old does not make it worth a lot.
That was actually what I was going to ask you. If there's less of an item, does it become more valuable?
Usually it does, yes. It depends, of course, on what it is, probably, but yeah. Anything that's one of a kind is always worth a lot more. Mm-hmm.
Like if you had, you know, a sheet music from Hank Williams, or you had sheet music from Hank Williams with a signature on it.
Well,
that's a lot more rare.
Signature would be worth more because, yeah. I don't know how many there would be with his actual signature on. That would be pretty rare if you had something like that.
Do you guys ever end up with stuff there, like from leftovers from an estate sale, or somebody that may have passed away alone, and you end up with antiques from the stuff that they've saved?
He has, just as an example, I have to think of right now, he has a Dukes of Hazzard collection, and he has a collection of all autographs of all the people that were in the
show.
Wow. Yeah, and that's...
Well, this is what
passed away or not around anymore.
Right.
So those signatures are probably worth something.
Speaking, that's interesting. I actually have somewhere in the pile somewhere. I have Tom Luke Duke, not Bo, the cute one, Luke Duke. I have his signature. He did some neat work years later. But anyway, I'll look up that another time. But what's very interesting that I had in my conversations with Elmer was, there's a certain time frame that makes things the most valuable. In other words, if it gets too old, it actually loses value because it's about sentimentality. Meaning some people remember things from their youth.
Yeah.
And so what's very interesting for me is certain things from my childhood now. Apparently I'm the generation starting to get money. And certain things that was junk when I was a kid are now valuable. Star Wars action figures. My parents thought nothing of these things. They were simple toys given to us now. And I remember one day I'm walking around in the toy shop, and there's this whole section of Star Wars stuff. And I thought that was amazing that now this is valuable. And the reason is because people of my generation remember this from their childhood, have nostalgic memories, and now it's valuable. And I remember him saying to me, if it gets too old where no one remembers it particularly well, it actually loses value. And so I'd like to play with this. Quiz time. So just kind of guess time. I actually went on the internet. The top 25 prices for anything on eBay. Who here has bought stuff on eBay? Yeah. So you know the idea. People bid for different items and stuff. What sort of items do you think might have, if they listed the top 25 eBay items, meaning money-wise, how much they got for it? What sort of things do you think might be on there? And I'll let you know if you're right or wrong. And just kind of guess. What is some of the... Some are going to be obvious, and some might really surprise you.
I think toy collectibles.
Not as much as you think. Maybe some. I'm trying to think, looking down. One in particular that I want to talk about later. So hold on to that thought. Hold on to the toy collection thought. What else do you think might gain the most money? Some would be obvious. Some are weird.
Barbie dolls?
That
kind of falls in the same category.
Yeah, it's in the top 25, not as many toys as you'd think.
Okay. Jewelry.
You'd think jewelry. I did not see one thing of jewelry in the top 25.
Cars.
Cars. There's a number of cars.
I was going to say that too.
The hot rods, the race cars. Not always the oldest ones, like the Lamborghinis and stuff. There's a bunch of them on there. So those are the obvious ones.
A piece of toast that you see Jesus on?
No, there's no piece of toast that you see Jesus on anywhere in the top 25 list.
When you say that with the top 25 list, are you talking about the value of them, or are you talking about the number of them?
No, the final price of that single item sold.
Oh,
Meaning?
You're looking at big ticket stuff.
You're looking at big ticket stuff, correct. House, one house on there. Yes, this is kind of interesting, actually. What is it? A house with a war-proof bunker sold for $2.1 million, and that is number 5 on the list. So you are safe in that house for some reason. So war-proof bunker house.
Painted,
you'd think, wouldn't you? Not on eBay.
Some celebrities use tissue.
Yes! Celebrity use, not tissue though, I mean no booger stuff, but one, number 15, Elvis Presley's 1912 piano. Piano's made in 1912, not Elvis Presley.
Somebody people might say it goes with
it. The piano that he played was the 15th largest ticket item ever on eBay. So yes, celebrities have interacted with it, touched it, felt it, things like that. Elton John's glasses is not on that list, but it might have been. Some things will really surprise you. Some weird stuff. And it makes you wonder. Number 4 on the list, the town of Albert, Texas.
The town?
Now, by and large, it was an abandoned town when it got there. The population had decreased from 25 people about 10 years prior to maybe 4 or so. But for some reason, the town went up for auction on eBay and sold for, $2.5 million.
Oh.
So if you have an extra $2.5 million, you can buy yourself a town in Texas.
When there's 2 people and no bank and no gas station, no grocery store, probably.
I don't know what happened to it. But somebody wanted to own a town. So for some reason, someone really found valuable the idea of owning a town. I don't think his name was Albert, but other surprising things that came up on this list that really...
musical instruments.
Musical instruments. Yes, I do remember seeing a couple of things like that on there. Not only
the piano
definitely fits. There was another one in that ilk. You guys are missing a couple obvious.
Violin.
All right. So,
is that on there at all?
Nope. But it probably is. That sort of. I mean, the piano is the winner on that. But yeah.
Costumes from.
You think costumes from big shows, and I've heard of that, like they wore this in The Wizard of Oz or something like that. It's not on this list, but that is a regular thing, big ticket items on eBay. So you're in the right ballpark, yeah.
Books.
No books. Says something about our world. No books on this list. Not the 25, anyway.
Okay, tell us.
Okay. So the obvious ones, baseball cards. There's a couple baseball cards. You support Honus Wagner? Does that ring a bell?
Yes.
Honus Wagner, H-O-N-U-S Wagner.
Oh yeah, I have that. I bet that's worth something.
There was a Honus Wagner baseball card sold for $1.1 million. You may want to look into yours.
I'm rich. What is it?
I want to get the will.
I'm not saying every baseball card of his, but one of his. What is it? And a lot of some sports stuff.
Coins? What about coins?
No coins on this, I'm surprised. There's a trading card from Tom Brady, early trading card, sold for $400,000. And there's another one I thought was really neat. Just give me a second. Oh, I love this one. Number 10, a baseball bat used by Shoeless Joe Jackson. So this is some of the, and the weirdest one, because it's my generation, not yours. A Magic the Gathering playing card. Now, let's need a little bit of explanation.
Magic the Gathering
playing card. So, essentially, there is now a large field in the area of games that are what they call collectible card games. So, you buy a little pack of cards, and you can play this game with friends, and they buy a little pack of cards. But then you buy more cards, and the rules kind of expand a little, as based on the cards you have and things like that. It's a lot of fun. But the very first people to think of this was a company called Wizards of the Coast, and they made something called Magic the Gathering. It was the start of it all, and the very, very first collection is called the Alpha Collection, and the Black Lotus card is particularly famous in that. Well, anyway, that particular card of a card-playing game, somebody paid $250,000 for that card. So, and literally, it looks like a playing card. It looks like a deck of cards. One card
with a nice picture of a beautiful black lotus on it, and it's someone paid $200.
Do we have anything at home we can sell this guy?
Do you have one of those in that big box that we moved from four houses?
No.
Oh, the Pokemon cards?
Pokemon, I do have Magic the Gathering cards. No, long after that. This is the first edition. This is like first edition stuff. So the reason I bring this up is some of the things that others find really valuable will surprise you. So we'll surprise you, and I want to throw
my husband. I have this value.
They're very good.
What's the price on
that? Are you throwing him on eBay?
Depends on the day.
Someday he's pretty cheap, isn't he?
Someday I'll give him away.
Another day, I understand, but
I don't have to worry about Danita knocking me off because he says I'm worth more alive than dead. So.
Well, that's wonderful. Congratulations. That's great. I'm very happy for you because my wife tends to watch those shows a lot, those true crime shows, and I get a little nervous. I'm like, is this entertainment or are you taking notes? No, she has a pad of paper out and write things down. I'll get really worried. But right now...
Better check her computer. That's
where
she
puts it. Oh, that's... Oh, okay.
I know better than that.
Again, and when she says things like that, I get nervous. Okay, you understand our services are filmed, right? Yeah, I'm just saying. You are not helping one bit.
I know, you just cut it up and throw it out in your field.
And you're also not helping, Patty.
Coyotes and that stuff will come and get it.
You said I should have a supportive community.
There you go.
Evidence 5B in the case versus. But, so, often, and I think Rusty kind of brought this out a little bit, is the sentimentality of certain items. And it may surprise you. I think it shocks a number of you that someone would pay $250,000 for a playing card. Or even, I mean, it's kind of cool having a baseball bat used by Shoeless Joe Jackson, but would it be worth $300,000 to you? So it's a matter of how much heartfelt meaning is in there. Hence what Jesus is talking about. Jesus literally looks at somebody who is giving a very small amount into the, not the church collection, the synagogue or the temple collection, and says that's the most valuable thing here. Why do you think he says that?
Well, it's definitely worth more to her to give this small amount of money because that's all she had. Mm-hmm. But I think about this in churches too. You know, some churches require a tithing of 10% of your income or 20% of your income, you know, up front, you need to pay that. Whereas our church has been, you give what you can. And it doesn't matter if that's a dollar or if it's $50, it's, you know, what you can get.
If you happen to have a Black Lotus card lying around, you can, exactly.
I'll be honest.
Yeah, okay. But no, for Jesus, there is a sense that even though it's technically not valuable, it is valuable in a real sense. And that's also why I wanted you to think about some things that you find particularly valuable. Is there something you hold on to? All right, look at that video. Jerry in the video is in love with these coins that he has, where there's those little R2-D2s instead of George Washington's. And everyone throughout the show was telling him that this is stupid, it says no value. And even the other the guy there, which is a version of Rick, who says, well, it's not so much about what its value is, it's what it means to you. Is there anything in your possession that you find really valuable that technically may not fetch a lot on eBay, but means a lot to you?
Yeah. I have a collection of 23 different guns.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them that my grandfather bought new, apparently paid something like $34 for it or something.
Mm-hmm.
To me, that's probably worth more than my target rifle is probably worth
$3,000. Mm-hmm.
Just because it was my grandfather's, he bought it new.
Yeah. I assume you had a close relationship with your grandfather?
Yes.
Yeah. And so, and if I'm putting words in your mouth, tell me I'm wrong, but it seems like this gun is a reminder of someone who is really important to you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And
And that becomes more valuable than any money, really.
Every time I look at that gun or think about it, I think of the first time that I ever shot a shotgun. It was that one.
Mm-hmm.
And my grandfather took me squirrel hunting. And it just brought me back.
And this is part of what Jesus is talking about with things that are valuable, even if they don't have a large ticket item attached to them. I mean, it's amazing, even if you translate what that widow gave, how little money that is. And yet, Jesus finds it infinitely valuable because it comes from an emotional place. I'm just kind of curious, any other items that you particularly hold on to?
I had a situation the same as Rusty, where I was... ruled my grandfather's 410 shotgun. I was the only one that hunted in our family, so I used it for squirrel hunting. I was a kid, and then when I grew up, my mother passed away, and I kept it. Well, first thing one of my siblings says, well, that thing is worth a lot of money, you know, because it was old.
Okay.
Well, I says, okay, I took it into the place where what did you call it, a shop?
Pawn shop?
Yeah. And the guy, I told it to the guy, he said, this thing isn't worth, you couldn't give this to me, he said, because it's not in very good shape.
Yeah.
Well, I said, would you put that in writing? So I had put it in writing, and I took it back to my siblings and said, no, see, this is not worth, I just want it for sentimental value. That's what it's worth to me.
Yeah.
You know, it meant more than anything, because every time I would use it, I'd think of him.
So did this letter get your family off your back about selling it?
Yeah, it was over, yeah.
Good deal. But you're right. So technically it has no value, but to you, it's infinitely valuable.
Yeah, very valuable, yeah.
Well, I also have an old single-shot 22 rifle that belonged to my grandfather. And if I was to sell it, probably wouldn't be worth hardly anything at all, but there again, that's his, and it means a lot, there's something to me.
Most people who work in antiques, when you ask what the value of something is, they'll remind you that take it to an auction and find two people that really want this thing, and whatever value you think it is will go way up. And in the end of the day, the value of something, and I'm putting in quotes, because the value of something is much more about heartfelt emotions than it is about actual value. Even though there are things, I mean, I used to collect coins as a kid, and you could look up in these books what certain things are worth. But at an auction, if something has emotional value for one reason or the other.
If you've got two people that want the same thing, guys can go crazy.
And often...
Like when you have a family get together, it creates memories, and that, like they say, it's priceless.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's worth more than anything, having memories with your family and friends. And you can't really put a price on that.
Janita?
Hi.
Hi. I was thinking, you know, that we'd like to analyze what Jesus said. What do we really mean? And try to look at all the possibilities that there are out there, and like sort of like they do with Beatles songs.
Yes, very much so.
So what did Jesus mean? Was he being sentimental, or was he talking about real value here? Her money having real value. So I'm thinking about that, and I'm thinking that, you know, the poor person, the poor people who make up the church, giving their little bit, their all, their everything.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes that's what makes the church keep going. Mm-hmm. It isn't the rich people who are giving a tenth of their income or, you know, something that this poor woman will never see in her lifetime.
Mm-hmm.
But because there's so many poor people and that the church is really a body of people, it's not about a bunch of money.
Mm-hmm.
That's what's valuable.
I agree. I think Jesus is really pointing at that her love and care is more valuable than greater, quote, value, larger sums of money put in,
out of a certain sense of apathy or duty.
Well, yeah, but there's still, it's real value, the people themselves, the group.
Yes.
The poor, or the middle class,
mm-hmm.
that compromise the church body.
Their love, their care, what they can do even.
Yes.
Is valuable to what's going on. Yeah,
they're a large group.
Mm-hmm.
And if you think about it in terms of like what happens in the world today, some financial institutions make a lot of money that way by taking pennies and nickels from the poor.
A few percentage points here and there that we don't think about over thousands of people make a handful insanely rich. And that would be borne out with modern economics, yes.
Yeah.
Very much so. Good. I like that. Good analysis.
And so relating it to me, what's valuable for mm-hmm. me? I was thinking about my pots and pans. That's what's valuable for me. I'm very practical. And the way they're valuable to me in terms of money is that they, I don't have to use a lot of oil. And I don't have to use a lot of energy to cook a meal with these pots and pans. They're made with copper and stainless steel and all kinds of components that make them easy to clean and economical to use.
Mm-hmm.
And so they have, over time, a lot of value. And part of the value is health, because I'm not using so much oil.
Yep. So they're healthy for you.
Yeah.
Nice. See, I was thinking about it from a different angle. For me, I also put money into cookware in general. But for me, it's the joy of cooking, and I like cooking better when things aren't falling apart. So, for instance, I had a wonderful talk yesterday with Jane. She came over and I made paella, which is a nice thing. It's an outdoor thing we make, and it takes a long time, and just it's one of those, you keep adding dishes and they cook up and then you put it all together, and it's really a neat thing to cook. But I talked about the grill that I actually put quite a bit of money into, but I said the joy of this is it's not always breaking down and falling apart. When I go to use it, it's there and it works and it holds temperature well. And it, for me, it's even more valuable than the cost of it, just because it's working when I want to use it. I enjoy it. And there's something about, you know, if you buy something cheap, it'll just fall apart real quick. And I like it being there, if that makes sense. And working well.
So
and holding temperature and things like that. Yeah. Yeah,
so I know that's another definition of value.
Yes. Yeah, very much so. And in other words, it goes beyond, I know it costs a lot of time, but it goes beyond its cost, because now it's really beat up because I've really used it. But I still like it. It's really valuable to me because it does the job really well. I guess, Rusty, are certain tools valuable to you because they're reliable? Now, you can't get much out of a pawn shop now, but you know, damn it, this thing works every time I grab it. There's something, back me up here, there's something to a tool or something you use that's always working well.
Yeah. You can go buy cheap stuff, but about the second time you use it, it falls apart or something breaks on it.
And for me, if I enjoy the activity, I just want stuff to help me with that's reliable and stuff. I mean, that's a value with me, yeah. I thought Rusty might be able to relate. That's kind of when you go to grab a tool and it works, Other things that we find really valuable, because when I thought of this, I came up with a rather strange thing, and maybe it's just where I am right now. I'll talk about that later.
My friendships with people.
Well, yeah. Friendships, it's amazing how much you can't be bought, and yet you can't live without them either.
Yeah, all sorts of relationships, you know. I met a man lady the other day just walking down the sidewalk, and she took 2 minutes to stop and talk to me, and, you know, I thought, geez, she's on her rope and wants to get this all worked, and it's hot out, and she saw the brace on my knee, so we started talking and even relationships that I will never see that person again. I always find those things valuable. They're part of my journey, they're mm-hmm. part of my memories, and people, I think, are probably the most valuable.
Jen, I'm kind of curious. A few years ago, you moved from a larger place to a smaller one, if I remember correctly. Mm-hmm. Was there something when you were pining things down, what can fit in this apartment, that you're like, come hell or high water, that's going with me?
I have a lot of sentimental stuff that family members have given me. I got some crystals from my parents' wedding anniversary. Mm-hmm. Got the punch bowl from the wedding. It's a lot of the pier cabinet stuff. It's like,
whether there's room or not, we're gonna find room. The reason I was thinking of you, because and Cassie and I went through something a little similar for a while. We moved from a bigger place to a smaller one. The place now we have is it's a little smaller than the old one. There was still a little pining down. So there was, in other words, the question is, okay, we have to have less stuff in the house. What's gonna make the cut? And what do you look at that says, I don't care how small this damn place gets, that's going there. And I was wondering what fits in
the
that category.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
All right, fine.
If you want to sit down.
Pictures. What's that?
Pictures.
Oh, tell me more, Rusty. What pictures make that cut?
Well, almost any pictures. Uh-huh. Bring back so many memories and stuff. You can't replace that stuff.
Yep. When I moved, there was a single item I found so valuable, I was not going to trust the movers or the moving truck. I was putting it in my vehicle and hand-delivering it over. It was a damn deer head. Because it comes with a great story, and it was the first time I moved here, and Rusty took me hunting. And I barely picked up a gun prior to that. And I will not go on and on about, but there's a very long, funny story where that weekend was a comedy of errors, a hilarious comedy of errors. Everything a young person could do wrong, I did. The harms showed me where to go and somewhat what to do, but I think they enjoyed the fact that I was screwing up every step of the way. But at the end of that day, one of the most biggest, beautiful deer you could get in this area, walk right in front of me, another comedy of errors, because it's running past everybody in the world and stops 40 yards from me and just stays still for the better part of 30 seconds. And it's a long joke and it's funny, and I got a picture of all of us together with it. But when it came down, when things are moving and this might get lost or this guy could move, damn it, that deer head was going. I remember making a trip from the storage facility, in one trip from Winona, in my car with just this thing. And I had my eye on it the whole time, because this thing is not falling over or breaking.
Here he is,
walking it in.
He's driving like this with his steering.
Cassie, I didn't ask you. You're kind of there behind the camera. But what is something so valuable at that time that when we moved in hell or high water, this was getting there?
I bet it's not the deer head.
One of the very few things that is not documents in our fireproof lockbox is the jewelry box you proposed with.
The one with the light in it?
Yes.
Yes, indeed. That's a funny story, too. The jewelry. All right. There is a special company, and Cassie is someone would want to be surprised when they're proposed to. And see what kind of ring he picks out. But she knew exactly what she wanted in this. And as the relationship got more serious and we thought about marriage, she made it very clear, I want this kind of ring, this way, and that sort of thing. So, and your look says it all. I'm like, yeah, it makes my life easy, but yeah, a little unusual. But this particular company had a funny thing about it. They put a battery-powered light inside their jewelry box so that when you open it up, whether it's day or night, a little light will shine on this thing, which is fine. And I thought it was pretty cool. So I set it up. The night comes. I take her out to the restaurant where we had our first date. We go out to the park, and it's a beautiful night. The skyline in Kansas City, sitting there in the beautiful distance. And I get down right in the parking lot and buy this beautiful fountain right in front of the restaurant. And I get down on one knee, and I lift it up, and then I go, will you marry me? And I hear the words every man loves to hear. Hey, there's a light in it. Why is that? Is that battery powered? She is fascinated with the whole, so that's it. But anyway, that box is what, in that little fireproof box, there's a handful of things that, again, come hell or high water, and that box.
That box is there.
Cool.
I just have a thought here. Rusty's showing me this picture here that
The unicorn?
Yeah.
What was it?
That she got last year. And to me, I'll say, now that's valuable to him.
Yep.
And I, last year I got a 10 pointer, mm-hmm. and the first thing the guy say, well, you gotta have that mounted. I'm not going to have that mounted. To me, the meat is more important than that.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I'm thinking about the meat. You can't eat that.
So when you're looking at them, you don't even care about the horns. You're looking at how much is on those, you know.
Yeah, but when you're eating the meat and looking at the deer,
well,
as long as it's not in your bedroom.
And you're looking at an unsympathetic ear over here in Rusty. I've actually, you know, the basement of his place looks like a freaking deer convention. Everyone's staring at you there, but you know.
And I can see the point, because what's your odds of ever getting, you know, one like that again? I mean, mm-hmm. It is a lifetime thing. So. I can understand that. So it is valuable then.
Well, and I think one thing that I found very interesting about this verse in general was how much our emotions and sentimentality go into to value. And I think this is partly how Jesus can find her gift valuable, is that it comes from an emotional place, that it comes from a piece of love. That's really for this woman, it's really a sacrifice. And I think for Jesus, the emotion behind a gift, the emotion behind these things is more important than the technical value of it. And I think that's a big part of what's going on. For Jesus, motivations mean a lot. Jesus is very unimpressed with clergy people walking around with robes and stuff, so he thinks they're doing it just to show off. But genuine acts of love and care, he values a lot. And I think there's a lot to Jesus about the reasons why you do things. Not just what you do, but why you do them. And so he particularly values a gift with little value, but says it has lots of value. All right, other thoughts, ideas around things of value. Awesome. Thanks, gang. It's been fun. And like I said, any other thoughts about what we find particularly valuable and want to hang and things like that? I do find there's some always interesting, when you move to a smaller place, it always tests your notion of what's valuable. When we moved Mom into her room in St. Anne's, it was interesting to see what made the cut to be... remember that plate, Rusty, that I ended up, there's a funny story with this. There is a plate that, it has an Asian scene on it. It's really quite pretty, but my mother fell in love with this plate. And it has a funny story, because some of you participated in what became of it. Essentially, in another Elmer story, Elmer, he came into a collection of 60 antique plates, some with all the original labels of the paperwork, and in a deal. And he didn't want them, but he wanted to sell them for a reasonable price. So Rusty brought them by, and I'm looking at these things, and I'm like, I don't know, it's not that, I'm about ready to sort it out. And my mother looks at this and falls head over heels in love with one of those plates. And I remember, because Elmer was like, you know, I need to get rid of these. I'll sell them all 60 of them for $300. And this is one of the funniest conversations I ever had with Elmer. I call him, I'm like, look, I don't really know if I can use this for a fundraiser, but my mother fell in love with this one plate. How much for this one plate? $300. And I'll throw the other 59 in for free. And I'm like, you little SOB. But anyway, but the funny part of that story was, so I purchased them. His mother was dead set on this one, gave it to Mom. It was Mother's Day or something like that, or birthday or something like that. And so the others, we did a fundraiser for the youth group trip that would eventually be the youth group trip to Florida. And so, and this is the funniest part about value. So we lined up the basement at St. John's Church with these plates, and people could come by and purchase any one of them for certain prices, or just give a gift because we're going to go on this trip and da-da-da-da-da. And other people said, oh, you're selling plates. I have some, and we will donate them.
Oh, no.
At the end of the day, at the end of this fundraiser, we had more plates than when we began. In other words, we had more donated to us than what we... Because they weren't many were listed as extremely high in value. But no one wanted them, and it was all about what was on it. Some things were obvious. Some things went well. There's the nature ones were pretty good. Other ones, there was a number of ones around show tunes. No one wanted them. No, I couldn't give them away for love nor money. But my mother fell head over heels in love with this one plate. And so I had, so it's a funny story about value and what was that. And yes, in the end, I had 59 plates I wanted to sell. I ended up having to give away about 65. Yeah, we sold a few, but we got a lot more in for it, which was really funny. All right, last thoughts. Value of the widow's gift. Why that's particularly valuable, anything like that. It's been a fun chat, gang. All right, thank you much, Lee. Last song is going to be As We Go. Please feel free to join me. And feel free to stay afterwards if you wouldn't chat. We have good snacks. What is our dessert du jour today?
Hummingbird cake.
How many hummingbirds does it take to make a hummingbird cake?
Very good.
There's not a whole lot of meat on those.
No, there's not.
So if you try to...
It's the feathers.
It's the feathers? Oh, I know. Oh, the feathers. All right, well, that awesome. The feathers or the cake? Oh, feathers. Okay, excellent. No, but I can't wait to try it. Thank you so much. Let's join me for As We Go.
Right, that is.